towards our home building in the next 3 years? Do we have a property? Where is our choice area? Or where can we afford at this time? I remember in 2005, we got married in 2004. And then in 2005, I was going to work on a Monday morning, got into my car. My car didn't start, so I took the public transport. And while I was sitting in the vehicle, they were distributing a flyer. They said they called it Common Sense Estate. Common Sense Estate belonged to Olumide Emmanuel. So when I saw it, I was earning 50,000 at that time per month. I took the flyer and I went back home and I said to my wife, I saw this flyer, they are selling a property and they said it's 200,000. Home and abroad, I didn't have money saved aside. And she had money, you know, which is why you should always discuss. She had money in her savings account and we looked at it. It was 200,000 in Ikorodu, and then we said to her, there's instrumental payment. Can we plan towards this? She gave me 30,000 of her money and said, go and pay instrumental payment and then let us start paying 20,000 every month for the next, you know, couple of months, and then we can finish paying. So I went to pay. I went to their office on Okwebi Road when Ify was still on Okwebi Road, Ify bookshop, paid 30,000, and then we started paying. Now, see what happened. When I paid that 30,000, every part of my being started working towards that plan, that goal. Because there was a commitment, every kobo we made went there. Everything we did was go there. 4 months later, we finished paying 200,000. That was how it was. Now, assuming I didn't want to discuss with my, you know, some people buy properties and say, I don't want my wife to know. Assuming I didn't tell her, I probably would have struggled to do that. Right? And that was how that property was bought. I'm not sure I gave you back the 30,000, did I? All right? So, that's how it is. Set the right financial goals. Have a discussion. What do you want to do? And two of you must agree. What do we want to do, and how do we want to do it? Can we, don't set goals that are higher than you, right? Can we afford it? Can we work towards it? Is there a unity of purpose? If there's a unity of purpose, it's something you can work towards, right? No matter how tough it is, just agree, all right? Now, these goals can either be short-term or long-term. The difference is the time that you're going to spend achieving them. You can set a 20-year financial goal. All right, in the next 20 years, you need to retire. What do you do after retirement? What are you going to do when you need to retire? In the next 20 years, you know, after you must have finished having kids, the kids are going to university. I want them to go to a Harvard. You know, you can say it every year, but don't plan for it. It won't work. My father would have loved me to go to Harvard. Right? My father would have loved that every of his kids went to Harvard. But he didn't work towards it. Just saying it and wishing it doesn't make it work. All right? You've got to put your mouth where your money is. Right? Now, avoid immediate gratification, short-term bliss. I'm going to explain this. Immediate gratification, now, zibo, zibo. Let's get it done and get a result quickly. This is a problem with the African man. Right? Everything around planning takes time. Okay? Do not plan and have a shabby arrangement and then you do what, you know, will give you immediate result. And then at the end of the day, you know, anything that is either fake or cheap eventually ends up costing more. It ends up costing more. Take your time and do a good job. All right? Short-term bliss. Let me explain this. When we got married, I was living in a three-bedroom apartment. I mean, we're praying to get married, so I got into a three-bedroom apartment. Nice compound. One hectic landlord. And you wouldn't know the landlord before you move in. After we moved in, the man started giving us hell. And then we got married. She joined me from Port Harcourt. He would say, start your generator at 7 o'clock and you must off it at 10. You cannot use generator during the day. You cannot wash in this area. You must wash here. You cannot spread your clothes outside. You cannot pound in his house. You cannot receive visitors at this time. You cannot pack more than one kind of compound. You cannot come in after 10 o'clock. And my wife said, what kind of a landlord is this? So she came in and she said, this man, you know, is frustrated. She said to me at that time, let us go look for another apartment. Then the apartment was 100,000 per annum. And I was earning, I was earning 50,000. So we're living on 100,000 apartment per annum. And she said to me, let us go get another apartment. In order to please her, I agreed. So we went around looking for the apartment. The cheapest apartment we got was 180,000 naira per annum. And then we're going to pay agency agreement, and then it was running to half a million naira before we now move. So we're going to spend at least 600,000 to move. So I called and I sat down and I said to her, this landlord we know. We know his weakness. We know the place is good. The one we are moving to, we don't know. Do you understand? Where you are moving to, the house might look good. You don't know. And I said to her, listen, at least we are making money, right? We're making progress. It means that this man is not even a witch. There are some of them that you move into his house, you go down. So can we manage this man for the next 2 years and plan to buy and build our own house? And I said to her then, rather than use this money to pay another landlord, and can I say this? No matter the amount of money you pay a landlord and no matter how many years you stay there, he will never give you the house. The house will never become your own. So be careful. That's the truth. So I said to her at that time, half a million naira, yes, we have the money in savings. Can we take this money and go and buy a property and begin to build? In the next 2 years, we would have finished building. It was that money, after we bought the Korodu land, because after we bought the land in Ikorodu, we decided that we're not going to live there anymore. We didn't like the neighborhood and all that. It was that money we used in buying property we have here, where we lived for 7 years. So we took the money and then bought the property and paid in two installments. And then we started building. And in 2007, we moved into the house. That conversation was had in 2005. We would have moved from that apartment to a new apartment and paid a new landlord. Maybe we would have bought another problem with our money. Maybe we never had built a house. Now, the short-term bliss in that conversation was moving to a better apartment, in quote, but create long-term suffering. Because you will get so comfortable, the landlord may not have been giving you challenges, the house will be so beautiful, that you get comfortable and you forget to build your own. The discomfort the man gave us was enough to remind us every day that we needed to go. In fact, when the rent expired in 2007, July, I went to him and said, Baba, I'm almost done with my house. Can you give me 2 months? I will pay you rent for 2 months and then we can move. He agreed. 2 months came, 30th of September. They hadn't painted the house. And I said to my wife, I cannot go back to this man to ask for another extension. We need to move before he moves us out. We carried our things. When we got here, the painter was painting. NEPA had not come in. We put our generator there, and then we slept. And for the next 1 or 2 weeks, they completed the house. We were there, and we're happy. And I said to her then, I said, do you realize that you can run generator till daybreak? I can come into my house when I want. No landlord will ask the gate man not to open the gate for me. Avoid short-term bliss but long-term suffering. Sometimes what you call short-term enjoyment creates long-term suffering for you. Have a conversation with your wife, and whatever, you know, I say to people, whatever I need to suffer now, I will suffer it to have a better future. Some people spend what they are supposed to use to create a better future, they spend it in their youth. You know, sometime in 2011, I wanted to buy a vehicle for my wife and I. We're looking for an SUV. One SUV for her, one SUV for me. And then we went to shops to buy. I got her a Hyundai iX35, which is what she's still using now. And then I went to Koscharis to buy, what do they call it? LR2, Range Rover. When I got into that shop, they gave me the price, 7.5 million. Before I went and came back, I think exchange rate changed or something, and then they said it's 8.5 million. So the car looked so beautiful, killer starting and a lot of futures. And I called my wife and I said to her, if I drive an 8.5 million naira car at this age, what will I buy if I need to change it? I needed a functional car, not an expensive car. Short-term bliss, long-term suffering. So I chose to buy the car I bought at that time, not because I couldn't have afforded something better or bigger, but bigger is not what I needed at that time. I didn't need to make a statement. I needed a car to take me from one place to another, but four-wheel drive. And I bought a car that was 3.5 million naira cheaper than the LR4, which is the car I'm still using today. Now, even if you can afford something right now, does not mean you must get it. Because sometimes you take yourself 5 years backward, and then whatever you should have gotten between 45 and maybe 55, 60, you spend it in your 30s. When you are 45, 50, 60, then that's when you begin to suffer. It doesn't make any sense. During these youthful days, build, and then enjoy when you are weaker. Because there's a time you will get to, you can no longer build. It's like asking my father at 65, my father is 65 right now, to start walking. Or ask him, you know, to travel abroad and go and, it won't make sense. Right? So avoid these pitfalls. Number three, have a family budget. When I got married to my wife, I was earning 25,000 per month, 2004. I saw my father as a young boy come out in the morning when he's going to work, and then he drops 5 naira on the table for lunch. And then, I don't know if it was 5 naira, 50 kobo or 1 naira thereabout. And then we buy beans, rice, cook for lunch, and then we eat. And then sometimes I see two of them, my parents argue. I want money for food, you know, soup, every 3 days. And the man doesn't have at that time. And then there's a confrontation. I want this. This is not enough. This is enough. As a child, I saw this. So at that point, I called my wife and I said, I wouldn't want to see what my father and my mom, what I saw with them. Can you give me what it will take you to run this home, knowing how much we earn per month? How much do you need to run this home? And then she said to me, it came back to me at that time, she said, she's here. How much was it?
12,000.
Was 12,000. And she said 12,000 per month. So when I earn my 25,000, I give her 12,000 out of the 25. And then I give her another 4,000 naira for her personal upkeep. You want to make your hair, you want to do this, you want to do that, please don't call me. This is from first of the month to the end of the month. That was then, the days of little beginning. That was in 2004. Then what, the remaining 9,000, I need to put fuel in my car, and then I need to save some and keep away. And we had an agreement that you must begin to save some money. And then she knows that 12,000, whatever you need to do, there must be food on the table.